what's your name? Are you for real? Is this a game? You start to smile and I do the same. I look away, but you remain. Your eyes staring back at me. My heart starts to skip a beat. I pray that you'll never know. I'm falling and you look in my eyes. You make me delirious. That's when I start to pop.
We market our artists because we market it to the core audience, just like before hip-hop was discovered by the rest of the country. I still look at it like that. You know, even my newest group, Vistoso Boss, is two black 17-year-old teenagers that, you know, my nieces, my little nieces and my daughter, they love that Disney Nickelodeon crowd, but the only thing they got to look up to and listen to is Miley Cyrus.
Right.
They don't have nobody that look like this.
Exactly.
So I'm seeing it with my own eyes, like, wow, why ain't nobody? Okay, so we go get that. But when I walk it into the powers that be, they don't know what that is. They don't know what my driving force is to put this group out. Well, where is this? Why are you putting two black girls that sound like this out? Because people want to hear this, like, for real. It's a little more work, but that's what gets me out of bed. You know, so that's kind of a old people from the beginning to now.
So, on the likelihood of who have you worked with? I know you've done a lot. I know you've been in this business, like I said, as long as I remember. I remember when I first seen him on a CD. I was an old national at Best Buys, I think Blockbusters. And I turned around and I was like, you know, I said, man, who's this? I think I was getting like a MC Clay D. I was getting one of them bass men. I just got me some 15. I was like, I gotta find something to beat. And I turned around and I was like, I said, I know that ain't him. I called my homeboy Marco. I said, yo, did you know Smurf got an album out? He was like, yeah, man. I was like, man, for real? I was like, yes, I'm from the Compton. So I went in, I bought it, of course, paid it in. I was like, I loved it ever since. So for me, growing up with him, just let me know that, man, this is what's up. So when I seen you progress, I was like, well, I want to know what's he going to do. I mean, are you going to just stick to that bass sound? Because like he said, down south, that's what bass was. That's what we did. You know, we was always in somebody's Sharon Showcase, Charles Disco, Silver Fox, Jelly Bean. This is what we did time and time again. In the A, it was always something to do every single day. Somebody club was jumping. And I was like, well, I wonder what direction you was going to go as far as with the music. I mean, did you ever decide to think about trying to do anything or crossing over?
You know what, man? It's to me, it's all going. Really, if you wanna survive, first of all, when you start paying your bills with music, see, in the beginning, it was fun. It was a hobby that turned into a profession, into a career. Then, as you get older and you develop a company, you have employees, you get married, you have kids, and all that, it becomes a job. You know, on top, it's always gonna be a love. You know what I mean? So let's just get it clear right now that if it don't make money, it don't make sense. So nothing that I put out, I don't care if you hate it to its core, because I've had artists that, you know, a lot of people love, but also a lot of people hate. But just know, when I put out anything, I've already targeted who I'm marketing to, and that's all that matters to me. With Yin Yang, if you listen to the very first Whistle While You Twerk, we didn't think that record was going to get outside of Atlanta, really. Because back then, that would have been a success for me. You know, they were literally naming all the strip clubs in Atlanta. That lets you know we had our core audience. We targeted the strip club.
Right.
Now, it was just so dope that it just transcended through the country. Same thing with Soulja Boy. When I found him and I saw the culture that he had created with them kids, it was incredible. It was like there was no way I could lose. You know what I mean? Just he had started something there that all he needed was a platform to take it to the world. So I knew, did I think it was going to be as big as it is? No. But I knew I couldn't lose on that level because I knew he had those kids. I didn't think anybody over 17 years old would ever get into Soulja Boy when I signed him. But what I did see was the potential of a real artist because he was so young. He was 16 years old. So the growth, and you can see it now, the growth of him as an artist, he was a kid. So now he's just now turning into a man and just really said, okay, this is what I want to do for a living. This, I'm going to take my craft serious. I'm going to work at it harder than anybody. And he really does. He works at it harder than anybody else out here. That's why you see the progression, not only on the music side, but on as a marketing genius. You know, you'll see him growing in all aspects of who he is. He's only 19 years old. Like, that's what were you doing when you were 19 years old? You know?
Wow.
So it's a lot of work that goes into that. But that's, to me, I don't just sit back and say I'm going to do this type of music or do that type of music. Because before I signed my girl group, you couldn't have told me I would be trying to do that. You know what I mean? But it's still rooted back. Like, the music is up-tempo. It's fun. It still has that element that I love. But it's targeted to a whole... It's a bigger situation than I've ever, you know, tried to target. So it'll start... What makes it special is that it starts. My motivation was to do it for the urban community that don't have that. You know, it's like we shouldn't have to go to Buckhead to party, have a nice club like Club Ritz. You feel me? It's the same concept here. Like, we need something of our own. And that was the motivation. Now, once mainstream gets a hold of it, that's when it's just pew. So that's what dictates, you know, what I do. It's like, where are the holes in the game? What's needed? What's not going on in the game? What can I do? For instance, like, a lot of people called me about this Thank You Larry record before it got signed up. Because, you know, I had done Soulja Boy, Hurricane, and V.I.C. Soulja Boy being, you know, at the biggest dance record ever, like, since him. And it's like, I don't want to go back there. How can I top crank that? I'm not trying to top crank that. You know, bring me something else. That's not to say that the record wasn't good, but we had already ran down that hole. You feel me? So bring me something else. Like, let's do something else. You know, I don't try to, you know, redo or try to recreate that same type of success that I did with somebody else. That you wind up losing in the long run, even if it works. Matter of fact, if it works, it's more dangerous for your future.
Right.
Because you get comfortable thinking I can do it again, and then you get you get stereotyped. Okay, he do little kids with dance records. That's all Collie Paul do. No, that's not what I want to be known for. If you recall, Yin Yang was probably some of the most controversial lyricists ever. And they were far from being kid artists. Soulja Boy, you know, Hurricane, you know, kids. It's all, but it made, I didn't sign them saying that I want to do little kids. Like, that wasn't what was going through my head. It was like, okay, damn, look what he got with these kids.
Exactly.
You know, so that's what it is. So even from now moving forward, I couldn't tell you. Something serious.